How many times in the day when browsing online, you're annoyed at that window that pops up and asks you to confirm your privacy preferences? And you can't remember which websites are to be trusted, which cookies are necessary. And if you're asking my daughter, she would go eeny, meeny, miny, moe with the choice of the day. Or you're booking a flight online and you'd like to talk to an agent and you go to the little chatbot just to be frustrated at the impersonal programmed options you're provided with. The problem is technology designers don't always understand what you're trying to do or your needs at the moment. I'm here today to speak about empathy and the relationship to technology design. Why does it matter? Empathy, that incredibly unique human element that we have to hang on to in the age of AI, when technologies are driving our lives and everything seems to be generated for us. It matters because the main users of technologies are people, and people design technologies. When we get empathy right, great innovation can happen. The typewriter, arguably one of the first assistive technologies. One of the inventors, the Italian Pellegrino Turi, designed it to help his blind friend write letters to him and unlocked our ability to communicate at scale. When designing with empathy, we understand the users of our technologies better, the world they live in, and the role and impact of technology within it. Now let's try again. How would you design technologies to help individuals at the risk of homelessness? Where would you even begin? In this case, an elderly man, we don't know if they have prescription glasses, likely not, have trembling hands. Technology designers, however, have challenges realizing this. They're mostly highly educated, talented individuals working in a computer lab, or nowadays in a coffee shop. We teach them to use logic and that there must be an algorithm as a solution to everything. What if we taught them to use their heart as well and try to understand the context of living they design for? At the University of Victoria, we did that. In an experiential learning program called Inspire, we asked students to work in diverse teams and get out in the community and tackle problems of social and environmental sustainability nature. We asked them to use methods of user-centered design and try to understand the context of living they design for. They speak with the homeless, brain injury patients, school-age kids, even in far remote indigenous communities. The results from our research were striking. When they used empathy to connect with the users of their technologies, that it was their best design tool that led to the successes of their projects. Today, I define empathy as someone's ability to see with the eyes of the other, hear with the ear of the other, and feel with the heart of the other. I'm also here to argue that in order to innovate in a diverse society, teams not only need empathy, but they need to be diverse. That is because technologies mirror those that build them. It is through diversity of thought and perspectives that teams get smarter. They can think through issues more broadly, they process information more deeply, and they have a higher ability to understand the subtle, unusual circumstances of those different from them, because they themselves have had different experiences and perspective than the other. You may know health apps missed tracking menstrual cycles until women got on the design teams. Now, that's great, but there's a paradox of diversity. While crucial, diversity comes with conflict and uncomfortable truths. Contrasting perspectives, while necessary and healthy for innovation, it brings different ways of communication and reacting to disagreements. We shy away. Diversity is hard. But what if I told you that in our research, we unveiled the magic of empathy, its dual role in technology design teams? When technologists use empathy to understand their users, empathy has been contagious. It came back to their teams. It allowed them to understand different perspectives, navigate conflicts, and resolve them. It is that relationship I would like to unpack today. But first, you may wonder, who am I to speak about diversity? I'm white, and as a university professor, some would say middle upper class and in a position of privilege and power. I was born in Romania, in a country ridden by poverty and oppression, where challenging someone's opinion was highly discouraged, listening to my own, extraordinary. I still remember first time that someone asked my opinion in a team environment. I was 17, and it was on a summer camp when we had to decide how to change our schedule because of rainy weather. If you wonder where I am among the pioneers in my language, that's me, yes, without a voice. Coming to Canada, my new country, I got a voice. And yet, the confidence to raise it took much longer. I was fortunate to meet mentors and teachers that believed in myself. I was smart and hardworking, and yet, writing that master's thesis, oh boy, required a different level of English proficiency I didn't have. I was learning the English as I was doing my research. That was not possible without my Canadian-born friends who spent many hours in the lab empathizing with my struggles and helping me improve my English. They empowered me to believe in myself, to believe that being different was a strength, not a weakness. In working with young individuals in countries around the world these days, I'm reminded of that humility. I know how hard it is to work in diverse teams. You may be raising a young family, like most of us do, and yet you do it while adapting culturally to different communication and working styles. If you change in countries like I do, you may be making elderly care arrangements from afar, fearing for the worst. We need such voices in design, and I know you can do it. And yet, when someone is consistently not seen or heard, the refuge is in silence. For the past 20 years, I had been fascinated by the opposite of silence, the science of communication. I studied many culturally diverse teams, and the striking, consistent, overwhelming finding we had was that the way we communicate not only affects the way we work and the health of the team, but the results of our work. When we do not have an understanding of the other, we develop blind spots and biases and prejudices. Let's take a moment. I want to ask you at work, how many of you have a colleague who always says yes enthusiastically to a job, to not delivering on time? And you're frustrated. I can't see the hands up. Have you considered that they may come from a culture with high regard for authority or personal relationships? They may have a different perspective and yet no confidence to challenge yours, or prefer not to for the fear of damaging the relationship. Would you then respond differently should you know where they come from and how that affects the way they work and communicate? That, unfortunately, becomes even harder as we accept to work in remote or hybrid environments. Spending time with the other, learning about the other, is much more limited. However, with empathy, we can listen better. Listening is seeing. Seeing those invisible differences that we have often culturally informed. And we can understand each other better. I'd like to return to the experiential learning program Inspire and tell you the story of one project in particular to illustrate the power of empathy in diverse teams, particularly the one that handled homelessness. The team worked with the Alliance to End Homelessness in the capital region in the southern Vancouver Island. They were able to interview many individuals that experienced homelessness. They used an exercise called Hopes and Fears, and they learned about their living experience and how technology might or might not help them. The empathy in one developer report is heartwarming. I had no idea what to expect going into a focus group with a bunch of people that had faced homelessness. I just went in with an open mind and tried to put myself in their shoes. Everything they suggested completely contradicted what I had assumed. They did experience a lot of conflict. They had different emotions around the complicated issue of homelessness. And yet, they were able to design a solution through many pivots, from an initial design of a mobile app, pretty much useless to the homeless, they learned, to one that was much more impactful to a broader community. They were able to build a platform that connected all the shelters in a network to provide much more effective response to accommodation requests from a long line of people outside. I'm proud to say that now they're working to take their prototype into a solution across Canada to connect all shelters nationally. How did they do it? They embraced the disagreements with empathy. They ended up using the same exercise, hopes and fears, within their team. And they unpacked their goals for the project, diverging views, presumably, biases, privileges as designers, but most importantly, their fears of failure, of not delivering on time on the initial design. They realized they needed to learn more about the users and how technology might fit within their lives and lived experiences, but also about themselves. Why did they have contrasting perspectives? They trusted each other, they opened up, they developed psychological safety. The empathy they built, the collective empathy within their team, led to psychological safety that allowed them to navigate the difficult pivots in their work. Psychological safety is not as much about being agreeable or nice with each other. It is about a culture of open communication and trust, and being able to raise concerns without a fear of reprisal. That's not foreign to behavioral scientists. Studies, even of large technology companies, of high-performing teams and well-being show that it doesn't matter as much who's on the team or how meaningful the work was. What matters is the psychological safety in the team. Our groups developed collective empathy that led to psychological safety, and they were able to build solutions to impact those that they designed for. What about you? How can you turn this magic of empathy, dual role of empathy in technology design, and have diversity crowdsource empathy? If empathy is a crucial part of high-performing teams, and it comes from understanding one another, I have three ideas to share with you. First, we need to rethink the way we work and use empathy as our design tool, not just for our technologies, but for our designing teams as well. Number two, shift from a culture of performance at all costs to a culture of learning of the users and designers as humans alike. And three, engage empathetic leadership, one that models open communication, free of blaming and judging, and models vulnerability in teams, because that's what allows them to develop psychological safety and embrace the power of diversity. In fact, in concluding, I have one more thought to share with you. When I had the idea for this talk, I wanted to inspire everyone to cherish and embrace diversity from my observations of technology design teams. But I am who I am because I was different and yet empowered when transcending cultures and countries. Why should my message then limit itself to technology teams? If there's one thing we all share is how diverse we are. And yes, we do have different ways to communicate and work, but empathy can make all our interactions a wonderful place. Let's consider empathy as our best social app, one of which automatic upgrade is constant use and introspection. I believe in a kinder world. I believe in us. Let's use it together.